thought every title needs a subtitle, and so I decided to subtitle my talk with the three things I hate about nanomechanics. And I will tell you in the course of the talk what I mean by that. So let me start with a few introductory statements on quantum controlling nano and micromechanical devices. Essentially, from an atomic physics point of view, all of that is completely old hat. And if you look at these beautiful experiments on trapped ion quantum physics, then it's essentially the collective quantum motion in a trapped string of ions that allows you to realize quantum gates. So this is at the heart of the seminal C-naught gate of Dirac and Zoller to exploit the quantum collective motion of the string of ions to couple individual internal degrees of freedoms of electronic degrees of freedom of ions with each other and then do quantum computing. Now, the difference is with respect to nano and micromechanical devices is we are basically blatantly using all the concepts and ideas that these guys have introduced, but we don't apply it to strings of to the collective motion of 5 ions, 10 ions, 15 ions. We apply it to the collective motion of 10 to the 5, 10 to the 10, 10 to the 15 atoms in the collective center of mass degree of freedom of such mechanical systems. Now, I just give you a very quick quantum optics perspective on that. The sort of prototype scenario that we have is an optical or microwave cavity that is coupled to the frequency of which is coupled to the mechanical motion of such a micro-mechanical oscillator. Then if you operate in a regime where the cavity is essentially very narrow, so in the so-called resolved sideband regime, then you can distinguish three different scenarios when you pump this cavity with an optical or microwave pump, namely the one where you pump on the red side, and then you see essentially to scatter photons into the cavity, you need some extra energy. Where does the energy come from? Well, if you're detuned by the mechanical frequency, you can actually take the energy away from the phonons of the mechanical system, of the center of mass motion. And if the cavity decays fast enough, then this is a way to essentially cool your system, because you scatter a photon into the cavity by extracting a phonon from the mechanical motion, and the photon immediately decays from the cavity, taking away this energy of the mechanical motion. So this is equivalent to the so-called resolved sideband cooling of ions. And this is a way to actually reach then so-called quantum ground states of motion through laser cooling with these systems. Again, in exact analogy to what people in atomic physics have been demonstrating already since the 1980s. Of course, on the other hand, if the cavity doesn't decay that fast, then what you get is a coherent energy exchange between photons and phonons inside the cavity, which is called a beam splitter interaction, which you can use then further on, for example, for storage of optical information into mechanical degrees of freedom and vice versa. Now, you can also pump your system on the blue side, and you see the only way to scatter photons now into the cavity is by getting rid of energy. What you do is you create joint excitations of photons and phonons inside the cavity, and in two-mode quantum optics, this is known as a two-mode squeezing interaction or down-conversion interaction, and this you use to essentially create entanglement between the optical field inside the cavity and the mechanical motion degree of freedom. And now you have everything together. We have a full quantum optics toolbox that you can use to essentially control the quantum states of mechanical motion. And this is what this whole field of quantum optomechanics is about. And turns out that over the last couple of years, all of those different regimes have now eventually been realized. So we have now cooling to the quantum ground state of motions using microwave or optical cavities. We have realizations of the so-called strong cooperativity regime, where the coupling rates overcome the decoherence rates in the system, which is essential for quantum control of the systems. we have, I didn't explain you that, but if you pump your resonance, you get a so-called quantum non-demolition interaction of the optical quadratures of the inside the cavities. You can actually generate squeezing of the light inside the cavity through the optomechanical interaction. This has been demonstrated. And also recently, the group of Konrad Leonard has demonstrated entanglement between microwave photons in a cavity and mechanical motion. So I think it's very fair to say that now, and you see the time scales. Now this essentially happened over the last 5 to 6 years. So I think it's very fair to say that we are now at a stage where we do have mechanical systems in the quantum regime. So this is basically, we are now at the stage where we can use all these techniques and start doing interesting quantum physics. That all sounds great, and that now brings me to the title of my talk. So now that I introduced you why I love this field and why it's so great, let me tell you why I hate it. So here are the three things I hate about nanomechanics. The first thing is higher order modes. I mean, in the ideal world, everything I told you about, you have this nice mechanical oscillator, and you have this one single mechanical mode that you can nicely actually work with, that you can actuate, and so on. But no, that's not the case. All of those stupid micromechanical devices, they all have higher order modes because there are these clamped systems and so on, and well, they just don't behave nicely. And I will actually show you an example of that. Then the second thing is dissipation. I mean, you just have to hate dissipation. No? And I hate it so much that I put it in twice. And it turns out I actually give you two independent examples where it affects us completely differently and where we are actually going different routes to circumvent it. So let me start with dissipation. One consequence of dissipation is something that came a little bit as a surprise to us, but then if you think about it, again, not. So the standard working assumption in the field of this quantum control of mechanical systems is that your nice mechanical harmonic oscillator is actually coupled to a Markovian heat bath. So basically, it's nicely thermal Brownian motion. There is no memory of your environment and so on. So in the case of a weakly coupled bosonic mode to a heat bath, that essentially means that your spectral density has a certain shape. It's ohmic. It's basically proportional to frequency. If it were the case that your environment would be non-Markovian, then there would be some drastic consequences. We have examples from solid-state physics already. Di Vincenzo and Loss pointed out already back in the days when they were studying spins and quantum dots that a non-Markovian environment would influence the coherent dynamics of the systems. And also, in the case of optomechanics, when you couple your mechanical system to these optical modes, it turns out that you can have, in principle, strong influences on the coherent dynamics, in particular generation of entanglement, and so on. So there are a couple of papers that have actually looked into that. So then it's a natural question to ask, what is the spectral density of your oscillator that it couples to? Is it really Markovian? So is it safe to assume? And well, the question is, how do you find that out? The answer is, well, just measure it. So we did that. We basically studied in detail the spectral density of the mechanical motion and extracted from that by basically assuming not the general Brownian motion and ohmic spectral density, a general spectral density of that form. Extracting the exponent, we find a highly non-Markovian behavior of our mechanical system. Now, at the end of the day, that, again, is not so surprising. And this is, I guess, one of the examples where 3 weeks in the lab save you one day in the library. If you look then in the literature and look back in the early days of gravitational wave detectors and so on, people like Saulson studied a lot the effect of dissipation in a mechanical oscillator on the thermal noise of your resonator, because the thermal noise affects your, the way you do force sensing and so on. And Sausen has this beautiful work where he shows that in order to take into account internal damping of your oscillator, you actually should use, instead of viscous damping, so velocity-dependent damping of your system, a modified Hooke's law where you just add an imaginary part to your spring constant, because you get a phase lag because of the internal damping. If you do that, then it turns out that you modify your spectral density of the thermal force, which affects then your force sensing capabilities. If you translate that now in the picture of a quantum harmonic oscillator coupled to a heat bath, it's equivalent to saying, oh, look, you have a non-Markovian heat bath where the oscillator couples to. So in a way, what we have managed to achieve here is a translational work between insights from mechanical engineering of the 1990s into the modern language of a quantum harmonic oscillator coupled to a heat bath. From a more general perspective, this is very interesting, because now you can think of follow-up works where you exploit this non-Markovianity in order to have possibilities to engineer the dynamics of your system through the environment. So basically, you can do reservoir engineering to maybe influence the dynamics of your system here. So I think this is really just the start. Now, so this is one reason why having dissipation in your system, internal damping, is something that you may not like and want to circumvent, or somehow maybe have a better handle on how to engineer this sort of coupling to the environment. Let me go on to higher orders. So of the mechanical higher order modes of the mechanics. I need to make a little detour in order to convey the message why we bumped into that. So at some point we thought that in addition to the nice two-mode quantum optics analogies that I showed to you, we want to have a different handle on achieving quantum control of our mechanical system in the form of so-called quantum non-demolition measurements. In essence, what we want to do is we want to have a measurement that is sensitive only to one and only one quadrature. There are different ways of doing that. You can do that in a stroboscopic way, that you have two tones in your system that you use to probe your cavity to your mechanical motion. That is something that Keith would have been talking about in his presentation here. They recently have had a couple of nice works where they showed that this sort of two-tone pumping leads to quantum non-demolition interaction, and they even demonstrated a squeezing of mechanical motion as a consequence of that in a paper a couple of weeks ago. The other route that one can go is to think about, well, how can you have access with arbitrary accuracy to a certain quadrature of your mechanical system, namely, let's say, position. And the idea is a very simple one. Here you have your mechanical system, and now you use an extremely short pulse of light. Okay? So the point is, like in an interferometer, when the light is reflected from a mechanical system, then the phase of the light that is reflected is correlated with the position of your mechanical oscillator. Right? That's simple. Now, if you make the pulse extremely short, such that so it's much shorter than 1 over the period of your mechanical oscillator, then the phase of the reflected pulse, the phase quadrature, is correlated to the instantaneous position of your mechanical system. So what you have to do now is you have to measure very accurately the phase quadrature of the reflected pulse in order to obtain information of the mechanical position. Question is now, how accurate can you do that? Well, the ultimate limit of the phase measurement is the shot noise of the laser beam. There is no mechanical information whatsoever in that limit. So if you now increase the power of your laser beam to an extent that the shot noise fluctuations are smaller than the quantum fluctuation in position of the mechanical oscillator, then you can measure with a precision better than the standard quantum limit of your oscillator the position of the oscillator. Okay, obviously, shot noise will affect the momentum very heavily. So you will kick this thing, and the momentum uncertainty will be extremely large. But that's the essence of a QND measurement. You have to shuffle the noise to some other degree of freedom, to mother quadrature, which is the momentum quadrature. So this is the main idea. This is how you could realize quantum nanomolecular measurement. You start off, let's say, with a thermal state here in a phase space representation. You have this extremely short pulse, and then conditioned on the outcome of your phase measurement, this is now your new mechanical state. So here is X, here is P. Basically, this is the phase measurement outcome projects you on a certain position eigenstate. So it's a squeeze state. Okay? And then what you could do is now you can make protocols. You can have it evolve in time a little. Right? And so wait for a quarter of a period, then do it again, and you see squeeze it again, and basically you can do cooling, squeezing, and so on. So really have full quantum control through this QND interaction of your system. So that's all nice. Then here comes the problem again. All of that assumes, so the time evolution assumes that this evolves with one single frequency. Okay? Of course, it's a mechanical oscillator, you don't have a single frequency. So what happens is the fundamental mode evolves with a frequency, the higher order mode evolves with a higher frequency. So instead of having here a nice squeezed ellipse after a quarter of a period, we will be back to your thermal state. Okay? It will just dephase and that's it. And then you start all over again. So this is why higher order modes are a real nuisance. Maybe just very briefly to tell you where we are there right now. So we started to do some experiments just with a freestanding cantilever, no cavity, and so on. And we demonstrated at least the fundamental effect that this is doable. Back then, so basically we were measuring so cooling by measurement down to an effective temperature of like 16 Kelvin, starting from actually in that case 3,000 Kelvin. So we intentionally drove the piezo a little bit, the cantilever with some white noise because the sensitivity was so bad, and the sensitivity of the measurement, so the measurement strength here, this so-called chi, 1/chi is actually the variance of your conditional state position quadrature. So if your chi measurement strength is larger than 1, then you achieve quantum squeezing. Okay? So without a cavity, our chi was on the order of 10^-4. Good. So this needs to get better. So what you do is, in order to get to a real QND, so to a chi larger than 1, you want to have a cavity. And this is what we started in a collaboration with Oscar Painter. We used one of his so-called zipper cavities. So basically, you have here two optomechanical crystals, so two photonic crystal cavities, and you get coupling here between these two strings through an evanescent mode that couples here. So basically, you have again the mechanical motion here affects the optical frequency of the cavity, and you get optomechanical coupling. And turns out the coupling strength is quite large because actually you confine the electromagnetic field here quite tremendously and the mass is small. So you end up in principle at a coupling that is larger than 1, and it should enable you to really do this QND interaction in principle even from room temperature. Yeah, so this is one of the nice features here, that this could be a way for doing quantum control even not starting at cryogenic temperatures. Well, of course, this is now how it really looks like. It's not just the one mode that we're interested in, but we have all these other modes that we need to get rid of. This is, of course, now it's an MRI conference, so this problem is very reminiscent to the, let's say, more early days of MRFM, for example, where having higher order modes in the cantilever was something that, like the Ruger's group has shown, is really a nuisance. And they have come up with some nice proposals. Here's one of them, and actually realizations, where basically by cantilever engineering, you shift other higher order modes to higher frequencies and basically reduce the effect of the higher order mode. So this would be one possibility, and we are looking into that right now. So it's an interesting question: how can you engineer such optomechanical crystal structures in a way that you basically do mode engineering? Another way that we have been going is, well, just do it in post-processing. Understand your system so well that you can do basically optimal estimation of your multimode state of the system. And when you know it so well, then just subtract it. Okay? And for that, the idea is to do optimal state control. So we essentially went back to optimal control theory, to the pioneering works of Kalman and eventually Belavkin, who applied it then to Gaussian quantum system and showed that classical optimal control theory is sufficient to get optimal state estimation of Gaussian quantum systems. And we implemented a full state space model of our system, so including all the measurement noises that we have, colored noises, blah, 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 in order to then basically have a minimum variance, in that sense, optimal estimation of our multimode state system. So you can see here, for example, this is our the signal of our mechanical motion. In green is the measurement, and blue is really the prediction of the measurement. It follows quite nicely. So we really have a nice state space model. And at the end of the day, so just to make a long story short, so here is our system with the Kalman filter off. And with a working Kalman filter, we basically can subtract all the in that case we subtracted all the modes, so and you can see that we basically go to an effective temperature, that's one way of interpreting that, that is much smaller than a Kelvin. So effectively, let's say for the single mode, it means that we although we operate at room temperature, we can follow our system so well that we basically follow the single mode motion of the system with an accuracy corresponding to 15 millikelvin thermal state, which in turn means if we would do that in real time, and we would apply feedback, that we could do feedback cooling down to 15 millikelvin at that case. And as a side note for the quantum people, if the cooperativity, so essentially this is just given, the variance of this is just given by the cooperativity of your readout. If the cooperativity would be larger than one, then you would be able to cool down to the quantum ground state. This is the simple message of this picture. Okay, so a last point on dissipation. At the end of the day, to really achieve quantum control, it's all about avoiding decoherence or simply just being faster, working on faster timescales than the timescales on which decoherence occurs. You have several channels. The one is the optical decay of your photons out of the cavity. The other one is the mechanical decay, dissipation of your mechanical excitations to somewhere, environment, internal, external, whatever. And basically, you can write down a couple of requirements. I essentially mentioned that already. And in all cases, if you want to have a large cooperativity, means your dissipation channels need to be small. And you want to have, let's say, long times for mechanical coherence. So also your quality factor needs to be large. So it's all about, in the end, it's all about avoiding dissipation. So the challenge has been and still is in the field, and Adrian also mentioned that very nicely, to minimize the mechanical losses, and with many different ways that people have been following. And I just show you one way that we have been looking into. We basically started out our whole optomechanics endeavors by really following this very simple idea that we have a Fabry-Perot cavity, an optical cavity, and one of the mirrors is moving. So basically what we did is we took one of the mirrors of a cavity, we microfabricated, so by lithography, a pattern into the coating, and then removed the substrate. So just we under-etched the whole thing such that we had a freestanding coating in the form of a cantilever. And then basically the mode of your optical cavity was much smaller than one of these cantilevers, and then you could do nice optomechanical physics. The one thing that always bothered us in the very beginning was that our mechanical quality factor of these things, so this was like a megahertz mechanical frequency, and the quality factor was always bad. It was always a few thousands, and no matter what we did, the quality factor of these coatings never became better. And these were essentially the best coatings that you could get. So these are the dielectric tantalum pentoxide silicon dioxide Bragg stacks, like 40 periods of this material on top of each other, and no room for improvement. So what we did was then, this was work by Garrett Cole in my group, we switched materials. So we knew that also gas L-gas is, of course, a material where you can make very nice Bragg mirrors. So why not fabricating these cantilevers out of gas-L-gas coatings. And lo and behold, the mechanical quality factor went up immediately by 1 to 2 orders of magnitude. So the idea essentially was that when going from amorphous sputtered materials, where the sputtering is a very brutal process, where you really introduce a lot of defects into your system, going to single crystalline, epitaxially grown Bragg stacks, that you would reduce the internal dissipation in these systems. And this is what essentially had happened. Now, again, only after we started to think about the results here, we went back into the literature. So this is the second example. And we realized that these numbers here, these Q factors, are consistent with what the gravitational wave people have been reporting over the last 10 years, namely that the so-called loss angle in their optical coatings is on the order of 1 over this value. Now, this made us think. Why is it important for gravitational wave people to know what the mechanical properties of the 5 micron thick optical coating on top of the 20 kilogram fused silica masses in a 4 kilometer interferometer are? Right? Well, the answer is the so-called coating thermal noise, which goes back again to the fluctuation dissipation theorem. So Adrian has already nicely explained that, and has been pointed out in several other talks. The point is, once you have dissipation in a system, you also have fluctuations. With respect to the mirror inside an optical interferometer, it means if you do have mechanical dissipation in the modes of your mirror, that leads to enhanced amplitude fluctuations of the thermally driven noise of the surface. Why is that bad? Well, because a cavity is a frequency reference. So if the laser bounces back many times, at each round trip, if the surface fluctuates, you get phase noise. And you accumulate phase noise with each round trip. So you want to minimize the amplitude fluctuations of the surface in your cavity. And this has been done over the last 10 years by improving the mechanical quality of the spacer of cavities, of the substrates, of cavity mirrors, but not of the coatings. So the coatings are right now the ultimate limit to the accuracy of gravitational wave detectors and of ultra-stable lasers for optical atomic clocks. It's really just the thermally driven fluctuations of the coatings. So now we ask the question, well, if this is the case, and if we now have a coating that has so much better mechanical quality, what if instead of making mechanical oscillators, we make a full-scale optical coating for a cavity? Would that in turn mean that we reduce the amplitude fluctuations in cavity and could make a better cavity that gets rid of this so-called coating thermal noise that is right now bothering these people in precision measurements? Well, I give you the short answer. Short answer was yes. So basically, we managed. So actually, it was Garrett who managed to come up with a method to bond such large scale. So you see the diameter here. This is like a centimeter scale disk of single crystal gas L gas Bragg mirror on top of a fused silica substrate, which is curved such that if you have 2 of them, you can make a cavity. And basically, this was done in collaboration with Junyi's group at Chiller. So we built this cavity, measured a nice finesse, and compared now the noise of the cavity with their strontium lattice clock laser, which is essentially the most stable cavity they have at NIST. And we extracted from there the Brownian noise of the coating surface, and lo and behold, it really improved by the factor of 10 that was anticipated through the fluctuation dissipation theorem. That's very interesting, because if you put in these numbers now, for example, for advanced LIGO, if you would manage to have to substitute now the coatings that they have right now at the gravitational wave detectors with these single crystalline coatings, you could actually improve the volume of space that LIGO is probing by quite a significant amount. That's why we are right now basically trying to do that. We're collaborating with the gravitational wave guys, both in the US and in Germany, to have larger scale mirrors now, and eventually deploy them in one of those right now still test gravitational interferometers. Okay, so this is essentially my summary why I hate all these mechanical resonators, because they basically all make so-called dirt effects. Now, I guess it's best to summarize it with the quote that Pauli gave when he was asked about all these nice condensed matter physics experiments that Pohl was doing. Right? And he said, "Das sind alles Dreckeffekte, mit Dreckeffekten befasse ich mich nicht." So these are all dirt effects, and I don't care about dirt effects. And by the way, he referred to color centers, right? So just to, as a side note. So this is why we are looking now into a different direction. Instead of tailoring now all these things, trying to get higher Q with mechanical by engineering the system or getting rid of the higher order modes, we now going in the direction of just removing all these constraints and taking a solid state object and levitating it, either optically or magnetically, inside here now, in that case, an optical cavity. So you can trap your particle here, let's say in a dipole trap, and basically now couple the motion to an optical cavity, and then you can do the very same physics that we had before, but with completely different constraints now. So in principle, you can forget about support loss. So it should, in principle, be much higher Q than you can achieve with just a clamped mechanical system. You can engineer the reservoir here. So this is something that is very, very exciting, because the potential and the environment it couples to is optically, and so on. So this is what we are looking into. And just to give you one example, so this is maybe a little bit of outdated plot, but it's a 2014 review of one of the, let's say, basic caveats of having suspended cantilevers, that at some point the surface effects kick in and your Q decreases when you go to smaller volumes of the mechanical oscillator. Now, if we go to levitated spheres, so here's one example from Vienna where we trap a 350 nanometer silica particle inside a hollow core fiber. I will show you in a second. You basically are somewhere here. That's not so impressive yet, but the group of Lukas Novotny and Romain Quidon at ICFO, they have recently demonstrated levitation at 10 to minus 6 millibar of a particle, so you're already here, right, with your Q over volume. And if Art Eshkin back in the 70s would have been able to measure the mechanical quality factor of his silicon oil droplet, then he should have been here. Okay, so this is a hypothetical data point, and the experiment was done, but the Q was not measured in that experiment. So what are we doing? What we are doing in our experiment is we have an optical cavity here, the two cavity mirrors, and we trap little particles, so it's silica particles right now between 100 nanometer to 300 nanometers. So right now we're working with 350 nanometer diameter particles. We trap them in the standing wave field of the optical cavity. So there's no additional external trap. We trap them directly in the standing wave field. Then we have a second laser that probes the cavity and does the physics. So what you have here then if you shake your cavity a little bit or kick the optical table, then most of the particles drop out and you're left with a single silica particle that is trapped inside the cavity. And what you see down here is actually now you scan the laser over the cavity and you see here these little side bands on the face of the cavity field, and this is actually the motionally induced side bands of the mechanical oscillator, of the particle inside. So if you park now your pump laser somewhere here, you resonantly enhance only one of the side bands and then can take energy out and so on. And this is, again, we are back to now resolved sideband cooling and so on. So we did that recently. We trapped the particle at 4 millibar, and we demonstrated, again, laser cooling of the axial motion of this particle inside the cavity from 300 Kelvin down to 50 Kelvin. That is not impressive, and the reason why this is not impressive is that we had to keep the particle at 4 millibar. When we lowered the pressure, the particle was gone. It was heated out of the trap. And that is something that has been bugging us for, I guess, essentially 2 years now. And it turns out it's really, again, a dirt effect. So we are now much more careful with cleaning the particles and so on, and we got an immediate improvement by 3 orders of magnitude in pressure by just handling the particles in a different way. So the way we do that is essentially we have these particles in solution, we spray them in, so we have a 300 nanometer particle and a 10 micron droplet. The droplet evaporates, the dirt in the droplet sticks on the particle, and when you remove the rest gas, the dirt heats up and the particle gets out of the trap. So, and if you are more careful now in the sample preparation, you can get to much lower pressure. So we are very confident that we now reach this regime where we start at pressures of like 10 to the 7 millibar or so. And this, with the coupling rates that we have here, should immediately bring us to the quantum ground state of motion, starting from room temperature. And this is sort of the vision where we want to go, having a sort of cavity fiber interface. So we want to trap the particles inside a hollow core fiber and then deliver them particle by particle to the cavity and then work with that. So that's why we basically have a setup now. I jump through that very quickly, where we have a photonic crystal hollow core fiber. So we have a hole here of about 10 micron, and you have a standing wave trap, again, where you can keep the particle now inside the hollow core fiber. You can trap it in front of the fiber. You can move it between two vacuum chambers, for example, and so on. So this is something that is work in progress right now. So just to show you, here what you see is actually scattering of a particle that sits somewhere at the rim of the fiber. So here the fiber ends. This is scattering off the fiber end, what you see here. And now what we do is we can basically now move the particle around. We can move it outside. We can keep it outside of the fiber, so we could deliver it now in the cavity, get it back, and so on. And also very interesting, we do have higher order modes, optical higher order modes in the system. And this allows us to also monitor the radial motion of the particle. So in principle, we can have, while the particle is trapped inside the hollow core fiber, we can have a direct 3D readout of the position of the particle, which should allow us then to also do 3D feedback inside the hollow core fiber. So this is something we're working on right now. Okay. I spent my last 5 minutes on where this is supposed to go with respect to the quantum aspects. This is a very crude summary of the current state of the art of massive quantum experiments. So this side. What you see here is coherence time versus mass of the particles that are being used in quantum experiments. Here are the beautiful metawave experiments, either macroscopic molecules, so biomolecules and so on, or clouds of ultra-cold atoms. So typically, these are like 10 to the 6 atoms. Maybe there will be experiments of 10 to the 8 atoms or so. Coherence times in free flight of seconds, incredible. But somehow, it's not clear how this can be pushed to the domain of 10 to the 15, 10 to the 20 atoms. If you want to go to higher masses, well, then you use mechanical resonators. This I showed you, right? And this is the domain where we are right now in what I showed you in the beginning of my talk. Here we have like 10 to the 13, 10 to the 15 atoms in the quantum regime. So we do see quantum signatures, but the coherence times are in the nanosecond regime. Well, if we want to go to even larger masses, there's a beautiful work by Ian Wormsley's group where they essentially show entanglement between optical phonons in a bulk diamond. So this is the collective motion of 10 to the 20 atoms in a diamond. However, the coherence times are picosecond. So there's, of course, a reason why I put this other side here. These are gravity experiments. I mean, it is really interesting to ask the question, can we push this side here to a regime where the mass of a quantum system starts to become so large that it can act as a source mass for a gravity experiment. So this is sort of an ultimate crazy dream that at least I have and would like to see some experiments in this direction at some point. And so this is why here I plot the smallest source mass that has been exploited in an experiment so far, here on Earth at least. And this is like 100 grams. Right? So there's no experiment where the source mass has been smaller than 100 grams in a gravity experiment. Now, the question is, how can we actually go in this direction? How can we bring these two domains together? And if you want to be completely unrealistic, how can you even find an overlap? But I would like to focus more now on the first part, how can you bring these things together? And I think I showed you a way. The way is actually using levitation. This allows you to have solid state massive objects at much higher coherence times because they're decoupled from the environment, and eventually using the techniques that we have developed now in the regime of quantum optomechanics to achieve quantum control over these systems. At the same time, one can exploit now the force sensitivity that Arjen has so nicely elaborated on for micromechanical systems to maybe get a grasp also on the gravity side. So here's a stupid example, and it's the last one that I'm giving. Just take the very naive view of having a mass-loaded cantilever and a second mass that just drives here resonantly this cantilever. And let's assume that we engineer this experiment in such a way that they only gravitationally couple, so that the only relevant coupling is the gravitational one. Okay? So as an example, take a 100 hertz oscillator, Q of 20,000 at room temperature, you measure for an hour, and you take a gold mass. So and here I plot now the gravitational force versus the thermal force of this cantilever as a function of size of the particle. Right? And what you see, and basically the ratio is the signal to noise, and what you see here that if you go on the safe side of a radius of a 1 millimeter gold particle, so a source mass of 80 milligram, then you already have a signal to noise ratio that is larger than one, and that should in principle allow you to measure gravity between two millimeter scale masses, and basically push the size of a source mass that has been exploited in current experiments by several orders of magnitude. I jump over the rest. If you're interested, just ask me. Of course, you can ask, what about the other forces? I just tell you, if you make the distance between those two large enough, then you can neglect all the other forces, including Coulomb forces. So you can even put 200 charges there on top, and actually it wouldn't matter. Finally, basically you can ask, well, will this allow you to measure gravitational constant better than people can do now? And there's lots of disagreement about the absolute value of the gravitational constant. People are extremely desperate. They even make plots where you see the gravitational constant depending on the source mass. And once people start to make such plots, you know that maybe it's time for different types of experiments. The ingenious new experiments in the realm of atomic physics, the Kasevich group and the Tino group using atom interferometers for making measurements of big G. But I would just like to point out that a very nice thing of our micromechanical method is if you push the radius a little bit, so if you go to larger than 10 millimeter in the sphere diameter, then it turns out that your signal to noise, because essentially of Avogadro, no? Because now gravity starts to increase when you increase the mass, it turns out that your signal to noise also increases. And if you're even so crazy and do this experiment, so here you see at a 10 millimeter radius, you suddenly have a signal to noise ratio of 10 to the 6, 10 to the 7. And if you're so crazy and do this experiment at 4 Kelvin, then you see that suddenly your signal to noise should skyrocket. And compare this to the current best published values of current experiments in big G measurements, then there is some room for actually going better. Well, but this is a vision. Okay, so here's my summary. Essentially, what I wanted to convey to you in this talk is the goal that we are having here in this effort is really to establish quantum control of levitated massive mechanical systems. The method that we use is both optical levitations. I introduced that. We are also working on magnetic levitation. The motivation in the long term really is to enable a new class of experiments where you push the mass of a quantum system to the point that they may act as a gravitational source mass. I mean, this is more in the realm of fantasy, but I'm convinced that we push in this direction, that there will be many interesting things coming up. And this is the approaches that we take. We take a bottom-up approach where we want to demonstrate long-lived coherence of our increasingly massive system. The top-down approach is establish gravitational coupling on a large scale and make it smaller and smaller, and hopefully at some point bring those two things together. Okay. With that, a big thank you to my group. The main people involved of the work that I showed you now here, Nikolai Kiesel, Rainer Kaltenbeck, Josh Slater, Sunkun Hong, and Vitlov Ijorek, and Garrett Cole, who is responsible for the low noise coatings, is now working on that independently. So thank you very much for your attention. No. Thanks for the question. So there are different types of fluctuations. So if you just go to the fluctuation dissipation theorem, let me say there are different types of dissipation that leads to fluctuations. The dissipation that you are referring to, fluctuations in the refractive index, for example, this is due to optical dissipation, so basically absorption in the material. So absorption in the material leads to thermo-optic noise. This is fluctuations in the refractive index and fluctuations in the cavity length due to simply thermal expansion. Independent of that, or on top of that, you also have fluctuations due to mechanical dissipation. So it's really the mechanical modes of your cavity mirrors and the coatings on top, the mechanical dissipation that leads to the fluctuations of the surface. So basically here, the magnitude of the dissipation controls the magnitude of the thermally driven displacement fluctuation.
Do you say for the single coatings, those mechanical fluctuations are less?
Exactly. I'm saying that exactly. So for the single crystal coatings, the mechanical dissipation-driven fluctuations are significantly less than what you can achieve with the other coatings. And the point is that this is the current limit. So it's not that. So basically, this type of fluctuation is what limits right now the accuracy of these things. The other ones are under control. So first one, what is the origin of this non-Markovianity? So the very honest answer is we need to work on that. the naive answer is just going into the literature of what other people have been studying in this direction. It is the internal dissipation in material. And of course, the internal dissipation in the material, so now as a macroscopic degree of, as a macroscopic parameter in your system, can very well be related to two-level fluctuators. So you certainly can come up with a microscopic model based on two-level fluctuators that will be the origin of a phase lag in the spring constant. So this is definitely a possibility.
No, this
we can exclude. No, this certainly the coupling between different modes we can exclude. So this is, it's really internal dissipation of a single mode. So it's, you have a single mechanical mode, and you look at the dissipation that is not due to coupling to different modes of the system. And also not to the bulk mode. Well, there is basically, so there are works by Ignacio Wilson-Ray, who showed that also phonon tunneling, so basically dissipation through the supports of the mechanical resonator, can also lead to non-Markoviianity. But this effect is too small in our case in order to be able to explain that. Yes, but it is consistent with assuming that we do have internal dissipation. The microscopic origin of that we don't know. Yes. Now to the second question. Now there is lots of confusion, and I can just only add my own confusion on that, on what you define as macroscopic in a, in a quantum state. Here, I think what I would like to propagate is a very simple picture where there cannot be such a confusion. What I'm interested in is essentially, can we establish gravitational coupling? And if you now, for example, take the take Ian Walmsley's experiment, so the optical phonons, which is certainly, it's beautiful. It's 10 to the 20 atoms moving. However, how could you establish, first of all, on a time scale of picoseconds, and secondly, with a degree of freedom where the spatial displacement is essentially zero, a gravitational coupling to with distinct effects for two possible states? I would say this is on experimental timescales impossible, on reasonable experimental timescales. Well, then still, in order to on my plot, yes, that's a good point. On my plot, it would be up there. That's a good point, actually. Yeah. So I need to modify the plot. But of course,
okay, that's still irrelevant.
It's still irrelevant because where I want to go is essentially quantum control of a center of mass degree of freedom, and then the difference in the two states
should be substantial.
Exactly. Okay, I will do a Misha plot for the next talk.